So, Adam, are you Team Cap or are you Team Iron Man?
Isn't it obvious?
Well, which is it? Hashtag.
Isn't it obvious?
Just because you have a good... So you're Team Iron Man because you've got a good team.
It would surprise you. I'm actually not.
You're Team Cap?
Yeah.
Well, I'm Team Iron Man.
Well, I guess that means...
War...
Too bad we don't have a bunch of other YouTubers to plug in this Civil War showdown.
Welcome, everybody, to Draken Shadow.
That's like my best Robert Downey Jr. right there. Welcome, everybody, to another Draken Shadow vlog.
Yeah.
Where as many have actually put in comments for us, where we take a movie review far too seriously for the format that we do it. Yeah, kind of. what can I say? To us, movies is serious business.
I don't quite get what that means, but okay.
We got a comment where one guy was like, well, a vlog is supposed to be like a casual format, and you guys kind of take it like a serious review. I'm like, have you watched our previous reviews?
I guess
we kind of don't. Because, we give our own score, but... a lot of times it's more along the lines of we take this very casually and we have fun with it. But yeah, guys, it's officially the summer, as far as Hollywood is concerned.
As far as the movie season goes, we're hitting the summertime.
We've kicked off the summer season, and wow, what a way to kick it off was with the next Phase 3 movie in the Marvel Cinematic Universe with Captain America Civil War. So... I'm going to keep this as short as I possibly can. Spoiler alert, we are going to be talking a lot of the major spoilers in this movie. And I'm going to tell you, if you are interested in this at all, if you've been watching the Captain America movies, hell, if you've been watching all of the Marvel movies, then turn this off. We will understand. We feel for you. And go watch this, because there's a lot here that not only... kind of gives a completion to the Captain America movie trilogy, but also sets the stage for things to come. Because if people can remember, you know, all of these movies set up to the next Avengers movie, and the next Avengers movie, well, it's the mother of them all. So this covers a lot of ground. So we will understand. Go watch it so you're not spoiled, and we're going to talk about this as candidly as we can. I mean, we're gonna go through all the details. So, in fact, this might be a longer vlog than what we're used to, because there's a lot to go over. So I guess first of all, we need to cover one quick detail, because we did get asked. I guess they were watching one of our past Dot Hack episodes, and they were concerned that you were up for Civil War, but you hadn't seen the previous movies.
Right.
Now, up until that point, you had seen Avengers.
Yes.
And that's it. But...
Well, not just Avengers. I mean, I'd seen Iron Man.
You'd seen Iron Man, yeah.
And I'd seen the Hulk.
You saw the Ed Norton one.
Yes.
Yeah. We don't talk about the Eric Mana one. So you'd seen those, but, like, you had no real motivation to go watch Iron Man 2. Well, you probably saw Iron Man 2.
I've seen all the Iron Man movies.
But you didn't have real motivation to go see Thor or Captain America.
Right.
Or, what was the other one in there? Did I cover them all?
I think
yeah, because Black Widow was in Iron Man 2, and then Hawkeye was in Thor, and yeah, that all led up. But since that video, you have gone and seen, I think, all of it.
Yeah.
You're up to speed. This was pre-Age of Ultron?
I'm pretty sure it would have been, yeah.
I'm saying you saw these movies before, yeah, just before Age of Ultron.
Actually, no, I saw them after Age of Ultron.
That's right, because... That was the thing that we had with our group review, was you were confused.
Yeah.
Because there was stuff you'd obviously missed. So, we're going to be talking about this not just from the Marvel Cinematic Universe perspective, but also from the Cap perspective, because this is the third Captain America movie. And so, I guess the first thing to start with is the things that have happened that have built up to this point. Cap obviously built up Hydra and the Red Skull, the first Avenger, and showed us the threat that existed there. Then in Winter Soldier, after all of the incidents in New York, and S.H.I.E.L.D. is getting a more dominating presence, we then find out that Hydra is within S.H.I.E.L.D. and how bad a concept that is. And that along with all of the other events have culminated to the events of Civil War, which is, I guess we start off in, I want to say it was Africa or in Asia, one of the two, where the new Avengers, I need to clarify this, because we're probably going to be talking about the Avengers, and a lot of people are going to go, oh, so the Hulk was in this movie. No, you've seen all the trailer footage. This is not the Avengers. This is kind of the B-team Avengers that was set up in Infinity War.
Age of Ultron.
In Age of Ultron. This is what happens, people. I'm totally excited with what they're doing. And so it's basically Cap working with, at this point, their candidates are Scarlet Witch. Vision is part of it, but he's kind of a pacifist. He's not really involved. You have Sam Wilson, a.k.a. Falcon. You also have Black Widow, who's helping out with this. And I think that's pretty much the crew right there. Along with, Tony's a part of it, but like what they tried to do with Age of Ultron is put him in a retirement role. That's kind of what this is doing, too, is he's very hands-off on this whole model. And so we come in on Cap doing a mission to stop a heist for they don't even know what it is. They don't know what they're actually looking for, but it's being undertaken by Crossbones. I can't remember the actor who plays him, but if you guys can remember the S.H.I.E.L.D. agent that Cap worked with very closely in Winter Soldier, that is the guy that eventually becomes Crossbones. So they take down their team, and apparently Crossbones' team was looking for a biological agent of some kind. We don't really know what it was supposed to do. I still don't think we ever found out, did we? It looked like blood, but we didn't know.
Just plot MacGuffin.
Yeah, plot MacGuffin, and this eventually leads to a showdown between Crossbones and Captain America, where Cap, before he's about to knock the guy out, finds out that, Crossbones basically plays on that one note that is going to work in this case, where because of the events of Winter Soldier, Bucky Barnes is very much on Cap's mind, and he wants to find him, he wants to help him, and so he plays on that note, and then decides to, he has a self-detonation switch, and Scarlet Witch unfortunately has to throw him up in the air, and she doesn't clear the building in time. So we actually see, like, a couple floors get nuked by this explosion, and obviously Cap and Scarlet Witch feel responsible. But one thing I will say that they did, unlike the DC Cinematic Universe, Cap at least called for help on screen. And I'm sure he helped with getting rescue taken care of and all that. That's at least one thing that I can say that Zack Snyder didn't put in the film that he should have. He's more interested in showing the chaos than actually showing how the chaos gets solved. Should I stop needling Zack Snyder?
Stop for now. Anyway, we'll get to that.
This eventually ends up in a briefing room where they get to meet with the Secretary of State, I believe played by William Hurt?
Yeah, William Hurt.
That was William Hurt? Okay. Yeah. And this is kind of how the... This is going to be one question that a lot of people are going to ask. How accurate is this to the comic Civil War? And it's fairly accurate as far as events go, but there's a difference in what actually sets the Civil War into dispute. In this case, we're going to stick with the movie, and then I'll go later into what the comic one was. Basically, this guy goes into every major event that has happened, that has been because of, and I'm gonna stick by my actions here, and it's supervillains that do it, because they're the ones that instigate the actions. Tony Stark, you know, Ultron aside, Tony Stark didn't want to unleash alien hordes upon New York, okay? That was Loki. And so we see New York, we see Sokovia, from Age of Ultron, we see Washington, D.C., although technically there were two Washington, D.C. attacks. because you had the fall of Hydra Shield, and then you also had Thor: The Dark World, where the Dark Elves were launching their attack on Earth, and that also happened in DC. Then you also had the attack in Nigeria, which was in Age of Ultron as well. It was where, you know, Hulk versus Iron Man. You have all of these events culminating, and so there's a building distrust of not just the enemies of these superheroes, but the heroes themselves. They're causing way too much collateral damage. There's casualties left and right. One in particular that we had to focus on was, and I think was a setting off kind of motion for Tony, was a guy or a son of a woman who worked for the Secretary of State who went out to Sokovia to help out with housing efforts there. And he was an MIT student who had a bright future ahead of him. So he decided, and unfortunately he was caught in the crossfire at Sokovia. And that is sad. Don't get, like, a lot of people are going to take my mentioning of this and my thoughts on it later as cruel. But, well, it is sad. They are casualties. And Tony does take it to heart. That's how you know Tony's a hero. Is that he does take this to heart. I mean, villains wouldn't give a schmitz about it. So Tony then works with the Secretary of State to create what they call the Sokovian Accords.
Mm-hmm.
Basically making the Avengers subject to UN intervention. Like, the UN can only authorize them to work. They can't act on their own anymore. They can't stop crises should they ever find one. And obviously this creates a division within the Avengers, because Cap, and again, this has been something that's been setting up in the last three movies, Cap does not stand down from oppression. He steps in. He's always, you know, ever since he was the little kid who got beat up in New York, he was still standing up for what was right. So for him, this is not right. And he therefore can't sign it. They also have this intervening event happen where Peggy Carter, so if you guys watch the TV show Agent Carter, the love interest of Captain America, she passes away. And this also sets him on his path. He can't sign these accords because he can't look Peggy in the eye and do it, kind of thing. And I love the fact that I actually had kind of a building romance with him and the grandniece.
Right.
Or the niece of Peggy, who also worked for S.H.I.E.L.D., and she was in Winter Soldier as well. But this kind of anchors Cap in the concept he can't sign these accords. Because if there is a threat to any, or if there's any kind of oppression, he wants to stand up. But then the one note happens that shouldn't, which is the very building where the accords are taking place, which aptly enough is being led by King T'Chaka of the nation of Wakanda. I'll get into my opinions on that one, but basically this is a way to plug the Black Panther storyline in there. And so we get to meet King T'Chaka and Prince T'Challa, played by Chadwick Boseman. So we get to have that kind of introduction, but as soon as the accords start up, a bomb goes off, and it just so happens that the cameras catch the supposed suspect, and it's Bucky Barnes. So at this point, Cap has to make a very dangerous decision, because he wants to save his friend. He now needs to go against his other friend. He now needs to go against the Avengers to save his best friend. And that sets all of the events in motion. He goes to find Bucky, which in turn, he has to involve himself in a firefight with, what was it, German Special Forces?
Yep.
So we get to have that fight scene. We also get, and this is after this has happened, so T'Challa is now set on a path of revenge himself because King T'Chaka is murdered. And so we also see the first appearance of the Black Panther here. I'm not going to go into the fight scenes as in-depth because it's hard to do anything like that. That's why I'm saying go watch the movie, because I could say, well, the Cap throws a punch and blah, 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 and that's just way too much detail. Suffice to say, they get caught So Sam Wilson goes with him to, you know, basically to help Cap and make sure he doesn't make a horrible mistake. But they all get caught, and we have another subplot building up where it just so happens that... Now, here's where the movie gets things a little wrong. The main villain was a character by the name of Baron Zemo from the Captain America comics. And I can't remember if he was ever associated with Sokovia in the comics. Really, I just remember him as being kind of another Red Skull, roughly. He was that kind of egomaniacal. Mm-hmm. And in this case, they decided to make him like a special forces guy for Sokovia and gave him a whole plot line along those along that concept. We find out that he's looking into a project that the Winter Soldier was involved with that basically lands him looking up Hydra files and then eventually Hydra agents to discover how to trigger the Winter Soldier, how to get him back on track, so to speak. So that at that point, they have the Winter Soldier, they have Cap, they have Falcon, they have all of those people back there, and we get to have a little bit of build-up between Tony and Steve. But we also get to see that Zemo has made his way into the interrogation room. He's disguised himself as the interrogator and decides to shut down the audio so that he can say the trigger words that will turn Cap, or that will turn Bucky into the Winter Soldier again. So he does that. Another big fight scene ensues because now it's Cap against the Winter Soldier again. But we also start to see kind of the damage that is coming out of this. But obviously, it's all one big distraction because Zemo's able to get away and he obviously gets whatever he was looking for, which is basically a location. A location involving a previous mission that the Winter Soldier was involved in that was basically to secure Super Soldier Serum to allow Hydra to create Super Soldiers. That's not good. Mm-hmm. So now Cap has to work with Bucky to stop these new Winter Soldiers, for lack of a better term, because that's the term that Bucky uses. He's like, I'm not the only Winter Soldier. So this kind of sets Cap and Tony on their perspective run towards each other. But before that, we also have to build up the teams a little bit. So we have Sam Wilson, obviously, siding with Cap. We have Don Cheadle, a.k.a. James Rhodes, Rhodey, siding with Iron Man. We have Bucky siding with Captain America. We have Black Widow siding with Tony. And then we also get to have the reappearance of Jeremy Renner, a.k.a. Hawkeye, where he rescues Scarlet Witch from being held under a kind of house arrest with Vision. And so then at that point we have kind of the battle lines drawn, except three wild cards are thrown into the mix. One is obviously Black Panther in his quest for revenge against Bucky, because at this point he believes Bucky is the one that killed his father. The other two are Paul Rudd's Ant-Man, so we got to see Scott Lang return and join Cap's side. And then obviously the one that set everybody ablazing is Tony decides to make a trip out to Brooklyn, to Queens, to go meet with hot Aunt May. We'll get there, people. And he gets to meet a young Peter Parker being played by Tom Holland. This is all the buildup that's leading to the Marvel Cinematic Universe Spider-Man movie that Sony will fund, but Marvel will produce. And so we get to see Spider-Man join Iron Man's side. So we get to have a big fight scene that's awesome and has a lot of really great moments and makes you laugh. Only to have a couple of major accidents happen, one of which is Rhodey takes a blast from Vision accidentally, which makes his suit, like, literally non-operative. Its core is gone. And he falls from a good... I think they tried to make it look like a good 5,000-10,000 feet. Well, probably not as much as that, but very high. And yeah. he was basically in a giant metal suit, which made him fall even faster. And that he's alive, but he's been pretty much paralyzed. So that kind of sets up a character arc for Rhodey later on. But this also pisses off Tony even more, to the point where he's not willing to side with Cap, he's not willing to help him out, until he starts doing a little bit more research into what went wrong at that interrogation chamber, and then he finds out that the actual interrogator was killed, and then he looks into Zemo and realizes, oh yeah, crap, Cap's right. But by this point, all of the Avengers that were on Cap's side that stayed behind to make sure him and Bucky could leave are imprisoned in the Raft. And the Raft, if people don't know what that is, it's basically a supervillain prison designed by S.H.I.E.L.D. So, or I guess in this case it was designed by the Secretary of Defense. It's a S.H.I.E.L.D. facility to hold supervillains. And so now you have this entire area of the prison that holds Falcon and Ant-Man and Scarlet Witch and all of them. Except not Vision, strangely enough. And yet, he kind of had part to do with that, too. I don't get that, but... Iron Man goes in to ask where Cap went. Because they follow Zemo to Moscow, where the other Winter Soldiers were kept. And so Tony basically plays a little backhanded ball with this situation. He finds out where he went, but he goes alone. He goes alone to help out Bucky and Cap with what they're going to do. And then when they get there, the real plan by Zemo is revealed. He actually wasn't looking to get these Winter Soldiers. They're all dead. What he really wanted was true vengeance. So we find out that Zemo's family was murdered in Sokovia. And that he's seeking his... That's kind of the overlying plot of the movie, is he's seeking vengeance. Black Panther is seeking vengeance. There's also an underlying plot line where we find out about Tony's parents. Because a lot of people have actually been asking, you know, like, they showed Howard Stark in the Captain America movies. They showed Howard Stark. He's actually... His actor is still in Agent Carter, I think. So... they've done a lot of that stuff, and so they also show Tony's mom, which, if people read the comics, Tony and his dad didn't have the best relationship ever, but it was the mom that kind of held things together, and so Tony has kind of a really big affection for his mom. So much so that here's a fun factoid, in the Avengers comics, the original Avengers mansion is actually a charity, I believe it's like a charity mansion, built in honor of Tony's mom, and it was supposed to be used as an orphanage, but then he just used it as kind of like a second home kind of thing for the Avengers, because I believe it's actually named after her, and I want to say Martha, but no, it's not Martha. No, that's a DC thing, people. We actually got a lot of crap for that, how we didn't call it the whole Martha thing, but I think Romney did. So we then fast forward back to this bunker. We find out Zemo's real plan, which was basically to set vengeance in motion for these other characters. Where Cap feels for Bucky, he knows that he didn't do these things willingly. Obviously, Bucky feels bad because he was part of it all. And Zemo just happens to have the right amount of leverage to really make things hit the proverbial fan. He actually has footage of that mission that the Winter Soldier did in the past, which just so happens to be where the Winter Soldier murdered Howard Stark and his wife. So, yeah. This sets vengeance in motion for Iron Man, and now he must kill Bucky Barnes, and Cap has to prevent him from doing that. And I actually, like, despite all the fight scenes and everything that happens here, I do like the fact that things turned the way they did, because we actually have a good moment with Black Panther and Zemo, where they actually talk about this, and we see Panther do what everybody wants to happen is that vengeance isn't the answer, only justice. And so he goes out there to kill Zemo. He's heard the confession. But he then decides, no, the living are not done with you yet, and properly arrests him. And then we actually kind of see things come to a head with Steve and Tony, where they both basically disarm each other, where Cap disarms the Iron Man suit, and Tony, I want to say disarms the shield, but that's not really what happens, is he gets the shield away from Cap, and Cap then decides to not use the shield anymore, because it was Howard's. But at the same time, he's not forgiving Bucky, he's not forgiving what actually happens. But this also sets things into motion that the Avengers then go into hiding, where they, both Bucky and Cap, rescue all of the ones that were in the raft and get them out of there, and then they will go to a remote location. And things end on Tony helping out Rhodey with his leg. And probably, I know we say this every time, but like one of the best Tony or Stan Lee cameos ever, where he's the FedEx guy. And is this what Tony stank? And I love Don's concept. He's like, thank you for that, and I'm never letting you live it down. Table for two for Mr. Stank. And things end on a... So the FedEx has come in. Things end on a letter given to Tony that's basically Cap apologizing for everything that's happened. The other thing that we didn't really go into it was that in all of Cap, I'm guessing, because they don't really show this, in all of Cap's research to try and find Bucky, he eventually finds out about Howard's murder. He didn't know it was Bucky that did it, but he knew that it was the Winter Soldier, or he knew that it was Hydra that killed them. So that's also another thing that kind of fuels their vengeance, is that he knew and he didn't tell Tony. I would actually dare say, like, the letter actually explains this really, really well, is that, like, yes, he did it to protect Tony, but he also did it because he didn't want to admit it, kind of thing. And that's pretty much how things end, but we do have the typical Marvel Easter egg, which was basically Bucky saying, I need to go back into cryosleep, because as long as anybody has the trigger words that can make me into the Winter Soldier, I'm not safe with anybody around. And so we have a nice kind of touching moment where Cap gets to say goodbye. He goes into cryosleep. And then we find out that they are actually in the nation of Wakanda, where Prince T'Challa has decided to give them sanctuary. Now, this is also kind of going in line with the plot for Black Panther, where his father wanted to make Wakanda part of the world where they've been isolationist for so long. And how T'Challa actually goes against that and says, nope, this has proven we cannot be involved with the rest of the world, and we must remain isolationist, which obviously is going to be the Easter egg leading into the Black Panther film. So that's pretty much the events of Civil War in a nutshell. Again, go see it, people, if you want the details. And we're going to go into a couple of different discussions here, because obviously this is a Marvel Cinematic Universe film and there's a lot to go over. Let's just start up with like the general likes and dislikes, and then we'll get into the other details. So what did you like about this film, Alex?
Well, I had fun with this movie, even seeing all the other movies, it's still kind of confusing because it's a lot of details to remember, but, but it is nice to have a sense of connection between all these movies and
yep.
see that connection that's been building up so long finally pay off a little bit here.
Mm-hmm.
And I do know a little bit about the Civil War story. Thanks to Linkara there. So
yeah. You can look all this up.
You can. So it all seeing that this has kind of been a problem with some of the other sort of standalone films post Avengers as well.
They're all connected.
They're building... This isn't like a... I'm not trying to gripe on that. It's like the fact that they are connected, but it feels like they're still separate, even though this is supposed to be post-Avengers, mm-hmm. and all these heroes are supposed to be working together. This was finally a movie that could do that, even on a slightly smaller scale. We can still have the Avengers slightly involved, while not having to do a full-on
great... Having to bring in all of the all-star cast.
And, yeah, so it's nice to see that happen here, to give a little more connection in this post-Avengers. It makes sense, everything pre-Avengers, but now we're post-Avengers, so it's
and that's something that Phase 3 is actually becoming known for, because if you think about it, like, the first Phase 3 film, Ant-Man, did that too. Because we had Anthony Mackie brought in to play Falcon against Ant-Man. So we already had kind of that moment too, along with the wonderful moment that happened at the end of that film, where we got to hear Anthony Mackie with the other guy's voice. Yeah. So anyway, go on.
So you mentioned, of course, this is everything that Snyder couldn't do. That's the way I felt about this movie too. Yeah. Is, you know, this is a movie where it's a good idea, and we kind of saw this predated here with, like, The Incredibles, is where you kind of address the consequences of being these superheroes, right?
Yes.
What kind of ripple effect does that really have? And how does that work, essentially, in the modern world?
These debates are held in both universes. It's superhumans in the Marvel Universe, and it's metahumans in DC.
Right. This is everything Snyder wanted to do, I feel like, but he couldn't do because he just didn't know how to do it. He just doesn't have the chops to pull it off.
I just don't think he gave it enough of a crap. But that's me. I've seen a ton of people debate this now, and I think, in all honesty, Nostalgia Critic and Angry Joe hit it right on the head. He wanted to do Doomsday. He didn't really care how he had to get there. He really wanted to do Dark Knight Returns. He really wanted to do Death of Superman. And guys, I know I'm spoiling, but at this point, if you haven't seen it already, you're not going to.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted to do all of these things, and he didn't care how he got there, but he wanted to do them.
Yeah.
The problem is that, you know, if Zack was doing this in the Marvel Universe, okay, maybe he'd be justified in it. DC is so steeped in lore that if you don't go into it at least a little bit, it really feels lazy.
And that's just another problem. I think that's a little bit... This is a problem that's a little bigger than Snyder himself as well, because DC is racing to catch up to Marvel, because Marvel's been dominating.
And before people actually start saying that, okay, we've mentioned this a couple times, that the Marvel Universe is a Gordian knot. Tie that Gordian knot about 10 times deeper and thicker, and that's DC. Because DC's had a good 40, 50 years on Marvel. Okay, so they've had 40, 50 years of continuity there. And lots of good stories in the meantime. So that's the problem here. You know, it's one of those things where I say that DC's strength would be to go into its history and actually have that moment. But, all right. So, go on, sorry.
So, Spider-Man. I liked Spider-Man in this.
Which is funny, because that was one of your main complaints in the trailer.
I just didn't like the costume, really, but whatever. That's a nitpick and a rant for when we get to that movie. I was excited that Spider-Man was going to be in this movie. I didn't expect him to be in the movie quite to the impact he does. I mean, I understand his role is still small. That's fine. I'm not going to complain. He actually was in the movie a lot more of a presence than I even expected. I thought he was just going to show up in the action scene. That'd be that.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's what a lot of us thought, is that he was just going to show up for the action scene and that'd be it. But no, we got character development. We got to have Tom Holland come out as Peter.
We got essentially a Peter origin story without having to do the origin story that we've already seen.
And even then, it still left room to do an origin story in a movie.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it was very vague with it.
Yeah.
So that was a good idea.
Yeah, it's vague. I mean, we're all hoping we don't see Peter Parker bitten by the spider yet again, because we've seen it.
You mean like we see Bruce Wayne's parents shot over and over?
Exactly. It's like
we see that Fox McCloud lost his dad. Yeah, we're gonna get to that in a minute, Peter.
Different subject there, dude. Or that we see Superman has to flee sent away from Krypton for.
Well, at least in Man of Steel's argument, that was a different Krypton. But yeah, I get the whole argument.
It's
there.
Just, there's just like X amount of superheroes where we know their origins, we don't need to see them anymore, just move on.
We know their origins, we don't care. Again, you saw the Nostalgia Critic Angry Joe video, right?
Yeah.
Where they put in the Batman Begins DVD. It's like, well, wait, that's Batman Begins. Exactly! Because it's the exact same thing.
Yes.
Okay, so the other likes that you had.
Oh, other likes. Solid acting from the whole cast across the board again.
Really good picks, too.
Yeah, when the time comes for Robert Downey Jr. to hang up the iron suit, I'm going to miss him.
Well, and that might not happen as soon as we thought, because now he's actually... I knew this was going to happen. As soon as he gets a reporter in there and he's having a good day or a bad day, if he's having a bad day, he doesn't want to be Iron Man anymore. If he's having a good day, he wants to be Iron Man again.
Yeah.
So we already have a story saying, no, he wants to be Iron Man again.
Let him play.
Just like Hugh Jackman said, no, this is the last time I'm playing Wolverine. No, I'll play Wolverine again.
Yeah. Let him play as long as he wants, but... You know, the day will come when he retires and I'll miss him, but...
And they'll reboot the series because they have to make this new Tony Stark make sense.
Or just continue on. I don't see this need to keep rebooting at
one
time.
Don't with Pepper. Don't do it. Don't with Pepper.
If they have to recast Pepper, then recast Pepper.
It's like you can't at this point because Gwyneth has already invested in the three other movies. So at that point, they'll just go, we'll go with this Pepper. No, you really shouldn't. I'm very much against Gwyneth, and it's just because she doesn't fit that mold, not for that character. Okay.
I think that's about it. That's pretty much the summary of everything I liked about this movie. Okay. Solid movie, I had fun.
So my likes about the film was that it maintained continuity. I love the fact that Marvel can do this, and DC hasn't had a long enough time to be able to show if they can or not, but I like the fact that we not only maintain continuity with the cinematic universe itself, and also with the Avengers films and all the post and lead up and all that stuff, but it stayed true to the Captain America movies, where we still have proper story arcs going on for Steve Rogers, and therefore we know where the focus needs to be. Kind of thing, because especially when it comes to Bucky, because we've had that friendship literally magnified to us in every movie, and how Cap will never ditch Bucky's side, kind of thing, because we saw that in the first Avenger, then we saw that in the Winter Soldier, and then we have this lead up here where you have a darkened Bucky Barnes who's saying, you shouldn't be around me, I'm walking dynamite, and Cap won't leave his side. So that I like the fact that they maintain that continuity with all of that crap going on. And yes, there's a lot to keep track of. Like, you're only keeping track of the movies. I'm literally looking at, like, the bio agents and going, okay, what element in the cinematic, in the comics could that be? Kind of thing. And sometimes there isn't anything major there, people. It's just they're doing that because they're doing that. I actually thought that the... Super Soldier serum that they were hinting at the entire time was actually a lead-in from the S.H.I.E.L.D. series, and that was actually Kree blood. And that's how they were creating new Super Soldiers. And actually would have been a great lead-up into an Inhumans movie, which is not happening anymore. So it's just Super Soldier serum. So I love a lot of the shots. I love a lot of the tones of this movie where... I don't know how to explain this, but in any other way other than lighting, where a lot of the Tony scenes were fairly darkened or they were artificial lights, and with Cap, I'm talking when they're contemplating,
mm-hmm.
Where it was a lot of natural light and it was always kind of brighter, like as if to say, like, Tony has the bleakest scenario imaginable in his head and Cap has the best scenario in his head. I also love the fact that the arguments were displayed perfectly throughout the movie. And here's the thing. This movie was not necessarily made to advertise everybody else. This was to pit Tony against Steve. And they did a great job of that in build-up. Because you had that moment at the beginning that kind of, well, actually, no, you had build-up from Age of Ultron. That built up a lot of that stuff. Then you continued that here with the Secretary of State coming in, and also with what Tony had to go through and what Steve was going through. And then you built that up even more. You put them in private glass rooms where everybody can see them argue, and it's hard. It's really hard to see these two icons of the Marvel Universe duke it out like this. I found it funny that, like, my nieces were telling me they were shedding tears when Cap and Tony came to blows. And that's how you should feel.
Yeah.
These guys are supposed to be friends, brothers, comrades in arms. And I also love the fact that they brought in a lot of past stuff where, again, Tony doesn't have the best relationship with his dad. And they brought that into the hatred where Howard constantly brought up Steve and lorded that over Tony. And that's also, like, that's building up to a lot of the problems that he has with him. And I thought a lot of that buildup, a lot of that release was also just satisfying. And yes, in a lot of these cases, there is no release. There is no closure. You know, Tony doesn't get closure for his mom. Bucky's still alive. But you also get to see Tony kind of go into the internal workings and say, I've had this moment out, and now, like, I could go cry it out, kind of thing. Which is what his mom would have wanted him to do. Not seek vengeance. But that's another thing that I really do love, is the theme of vengeance in this entire movie. Where you have Zemo trying to get back at Cap. You have Iron Man, or you have Tony trying to get vengeance for his mom. You have T'Challa trying to get vengeance for his father. You have tons of concepts of vengeance. And then you also have a concepts of love in there, where you can tell that Tony did consider Steve a friend. They also kind of built up the relationship between Scarlet Witch and Vision, and how that was hard because Vision didn't want to keep her a prisoner. And I love a lot of that concept. I love the fact that it's even shown in the subheroes too. I'm gushing, obviously, and a lot of the details that I want to go into are in the next the few questions that I'm going to ask here. So first question is, I want to kind of split things up like I did with Age of Ultron, where we had continuing storylines, and in this case, I'm actually going to split things up as far as the storylines of the characters, because we have new characters, but we also have old existing characters. And so I'm going to start with the older existing characters and the continuations, and I want to define this really quick. As far as, like, old characters in this movie, we have Tony's storyline, we have Steve's storyline, we have Black Widow's storyline, Hawkeye, and yeah, that's pretty much it. Like, stick within those four. Like, how do you feel they did with their story buildup, with where those characters are at in Civil War and where they end up at the end?
Right. Well, most of this movie is Tony and Cap and...
Mm-hmm.
So I think those two having the most exposure and seeing them go at each other, because they have such a strong polar opposite view of the world. And you're right, this has been built up since Age of Ultron, where Tony kind of, that's where Tony is more or less pessimistic,
because
he's seen the worst, because he's experienced the worst, because this goes back all the way to Iron Man 1, where. Mm-hmm. He's out in the desert, and a bunch of U.S. soldiers get killed by one of his own bombs.
Well, and he's lived through the pessimistic scenario.
Yeah. So that's why you can see Tony's got that worldly view on it, because he's been there. He's seen, and he mentions it, of course, in this movie, where I've seen what happens when my own weapons fall into wrong hands. I'm worried that's going to happen with us. That's why I want this. And Cap makes his compelling argument, though. You know, doesn't this tie our hands? Doesn't this limit us? Doesn't this take away our own rights as superhumans, as enhanced people, whatever? And doesn't this just put restrictions against our right of choice here?
And also, does this make us the bad guys?
Yeah.
Which I think Cap tried to emphasize each and every time, that yes, these things happened around us, but we're not the bad guys here.
Mm-hmm.
We tried to help as best as we could, and sometimes crap like this hits the fan.
Right.
So you're talking a lot about the Tony storyline. I would agree with you there. I think a lot of build up there is properly displayed. We've seen these characters come full circle from their first film. They brought in the elements of the Avengers films, and then we actually get to have a little bit more development with those two that started in Age of Ultron, where we have the wood chopping scene. And I agree with you. I think this movie kind of painted Tony as the ultimate pessimist, and it painted Steve as the ultimate optimist, which is what should have happened. Because again, this is one of those things that happened in the Civil War comic. I'm going to bring this detail in now because people are going to want it in. So there is a key difference here between the comic and the movie. In the movie, it's the Sokovian Accords, where so much battle damage has happened because of Avengers trying to come in and save the day that people have become afraid of them. In the comic, it was more along the lines of, it was called the Superhuman Registration Act, I think.
Right.
Where Congress basically wanted known superheroes and villains to register in a directory where they could keep track. And all of this, again, the Sokovian Accords kind of approach this in the same, we're all doing this for the sake of safety, for the sake of security. But the problem is that once you put the Avengers solely in the hands of the UN, and the UN has its own agenda, then you end up with a... And Cap is kind of right in this concept, where you end up in another S.H.I.E.L.D. being Hydra situation,
yeah.
Where eventually we could be used for the wrongdoing, and therefore we shouldn't be involved in this kind of concept. One of the reasons we don't get a Superhuman Registration Act in Civil War is because there was another major factor in the Marvel Universe that we can't go into here, which was the emergence of mutants. And so therefore, there were tons of mutants, both good and bad, that needed to be registered, that needed to be watched, that needed to be contained in some cases. You know, like Magneto, he needs to be contained in an entirely plastic prison, otherwise he can get out. You had mutants that were literally dangerous to themselves and others, and therefore needed to be contained for their own safety as well as the safety of others. This couldn't happen here because obviously X-Men is owned by Fox, and therefore we can't go into that concept. So they instead created the Sokovian Accords, where so much battle damage is being done by heroes that now people are afraid of the heroes too.
I think you could have still tied in a superhero registration thing.
They technically did, because with the Sokovian Accords, you know, basically what they were saying is, because, and I especially loved how they did this, where they needed Cap's signature, otherwise he was a criminal, because in essence they were saying Cap has to register, and Cap didn't want to register, and because that's against freedom, as far as he is concerned. And that's the other thing that comes into the comics, is where, yes, you can approach this from the concept of security and people want to feel safe, but Cap has always in the comics approached things from a freedom perspective. Is this hindering your freedom, or is it expanding it? And if it hinders it, he's against it. So that's kind of the premise here. And it's brilliantly done how they actually do that. And they also brilliantly do it with their developments. This makes sense for Tony to be on this side. Granted, we had to have the one kid forced in, which made me feel kind of bad, because that was a cameo from a really great actress that was kind of wasted. Because she only shows up once. But Cap, it makes sense why he is on his side of the argument. Because he's seen Hydra come out of S.H.I.E.L.D. He's seen Hydra be the monster that it is. And he knows what can happen when you put people behind agendas and all of that. So, we've been talking a lot about the development of Steve and Tony, and we like that, but let's get into Black Widow and Hawkeye, where they were at. So the way that we kind of understand this is, ultimately, Black Widow ends up on Iron Man's side, which I think in the comics she actually ends up on Cap's side, but I can't remember. She may have also been a villain at that point, so I don't remember entirely, but she ends up on Iron Man's side, and I think a lot of that was given her storyline from Winter Soldier, where she's been outed as this major
whistleblower
killer, And therefore, given what she's had to do in Winter Soldier, she has to take this step. Otherwise, people are going to start questioning her motives again. And she wants to keep people's trust. Granted, she does in turn double agent again. But I think she did that more from the lines of, this can end one of two ways. I can kill Steve, and I don't want to kill him. Or I let him save the day and let whatever happens, happens. Kind of thing. So I do like the... I actually think if a viewer is feeling conflict amongst these two Titans going at it, they're probably in Black Widow's position.
Yeah.
Where they don't want to see these two friends fight, but they got to get it out of their system. Kind of thing. I also like Hawkeye's development because he came out of retirement for this. Like, they kept the whole storyline of Age of Ultron where he retires. He's done. But he comes back because Cap asks him to. And that shows just how stand-up a guy he is. But I also like the fact that they kind of reference that he's keeping old favors with Scarlet Witch, which references back to Quicksilver and the sacrifice that he made at Age of Ultron. So, what did you think of Black Widow and Hawkeye's development in the movie?
I personally didn't see too much, which is fine, because they got plenty in Age of Ultron.
Yeah.
Because to me, this is pure... I don't want to say purely, I guess, but to me, this is mostly Steve and Tony's movie here.
Well, yeah, they're the pivotal right. moment, the right. fulcrum of this movie.
So, to me, and the minor characters, Scarlet Witch, Hawkeye, Black Widow... Ant-Man, so on and so forth here. They're there to help be the vessels that we see each side through, basically.
Mm-hmm.
So, I can't detail too much, I guess, about that. It is interesting to see that. I think you're right, though, that Black Widow is essentially, she has to be the middleman here. She has
She's
to be
very
the,
torn.
The neutral party, basically, because... She sees both sides of what they both see.
Not only that, but she negotiates with both of them. Mm-hmm. And she's hard with both of them. I love the fact that she was hard with Steve. And the fact, you know, like, she goes into the church with him and he says, I can't sign it. And she's like, I know you can't. But she still didn't want him to be alone. And then she, in turn, also is hard with Tony. And I actually think that was one of the better moments for Tony, where she literally looks him in the eye and goes, Can you just let go of your ego for one second? For one goddamn second.
Yeah.
Because that's been one of the problems that we've seen built up throughout the Iron Man movies. Is his ego gets him in trouble. And he knows it. So, with that, we've gone into the older heroes. Let's get into the newer ones. Now, some of them at this point have had development. Obviously, Anthony Mackie has, because he was in Winter Soldier. He went into Age of Ultron. Vision got developed in Age of Ultron. Scarlet Witch also. But we also have some new blood in there too, because we have Paul Rudd as Scott Lang. We have Tom Holland as Peter Parker. We'll get into the new guys, especially the new guys who are there to promote their movies. How do we feel like they did as far as their development? Do we feel that Tony and Steve unjustly stole the spotlight away from them, or did they get proper development as well?
I think they're in the movie as much as they need to be, because I'm going to state again, Tony and Steve's movie here. They are the catalyst of this plot, so the others I'm not too concerned about with.
Concerned in the concept that they basically ended up as collateral damage.
Yeah,
in this.
That, you know, that's where I see them, unfortunately, is they do become the collateral damage, because four or five of them get imprisoned after...
All of them pretty much do, aside from Rhodey. Peter goes home.
Right,
but...
everybody essentially who was on Cap's side here...
Yes.
Is put in jail.
Mm-hmm.
So... Right, I mean, we get Black Panther, we're getting set up, we're getting the seeds sown for these guys when they get their own standalone projects here.
Yep. I would especially say that they kind of helped the Civil War too, because again, I pointed this out, and if you don't know this in the comics, Vision and Scarlet Witch are married. They get married at one point. And so they actually did a little bit of relationship development with this film. They, you know, like where Vision actually is showing an interest in her and he wants to help her. He goes and cooks a meal for her and he doesn't understand any of that. That's the other thing I liked is that they kept the whole theme going of from Age of Ultron where he's still learning. You know, he's not like this ultra-powerful supercomputer kind of android thing that everybody is expecting him to be. No, he's learning just as much as anybody else. So then they also have that kind of relationship building where Vision is trying to help Wanda figure out if she is a danger to herself and others, as well as trying to figure out that for himself. And he even has a moment where he questions himself because he's the reason Rhodey ends up in an accident. So I thought that was a great concept because that shows that, you know, even though Tony and Steve are the fulcrum upon which this movie turns, that there is collateral damage and sometimes it's people. I liked Rhodey's development personally because, I mean, if you look back at the Iron Man films, Rhodey gets very little. You know, he got, I mean, first of all, we recast Rhodey in between 1 and 2. To give Don Cheadle the role. And I actually still think that the guy they had in 1 should have stayed Rhodey.
You like Terrence Stamp better?
I liked him a lot better. He fit the role a little bit better. Mm-hmm. I like Don Cheadle, but I'm all for consistency. So, but if you look back on those movies, how much development Don had, he didn't have much. He was kind of a comic relief character questioning Tony's decisions. In Iron Man 3, he goes up against Tony because he's the Iron Patriot and he's supposed to be standing for the military, whereas Tony is not. And in this one, they've stuck with the whole concept of that they are friends and that, you know, Tony has other motivators for why he tries to save the day the way he does. Because Rhodey's a major inspiration. I also like the fact that Rhodey stuck with his motivations in the previous movie and why he would sign the Sokovian Accords. Because he's a military guy. He's always been. He always sides with the military in these major issues, and the military is saying, this is where it needs to go, and here is why, and it makes sense. So I like that concept. I also like the fact that Sam stayed the way he did, sticking with Cap, and not just necessarily to be a friend with Cap, but also to make sure Cap doesn't make a horrible choice. I love the fact that Bucky and him were butting heads the entire time. That they just didn't like each other, and I like that aesthetic, that dynamic, because, well, that's how they should be. That's literally how Sam's looking at this. Let's see, who else am I leaving out of this? The other three we'll get into in a second, because I really do want to get into them a little bit more with their own movies. The other one I want to bring up is Sebastian Stan. So, Bucky. Now, he was kind of a villain in the first movie, or in the second movie.
Mm-hmm.
He's kind of a sympathetic villain here. Like, they don't paint him to be a good guy. They paint him to be a dangerous guy. But you still kind of feel bad for him because he's also a man outside of time. And it's not because he was frozen. Well, it is, kind of. But he was made to do a lot of horrible things that he regrets. And, like, how do we feel about Sebastian's performance trying to show the regret the Winter Soldier has over his life? And
he did a great job. I liked him.
I liked him in both of these movies, and I really wish we could get more. I want to see him come back for Infinity War. I want to see him miraculously cured and to let him come back and fight for the Avengers. Because I believe he is, like, a third or fourth tier Avenger, so you could technically do it. Let's get into the three movies, and I don't think there's a whole lot we disliked about this film. No, I don't think there's a whole lot we can go into that, so we'll probably skip that step.
Well, there's a few things I could point out.
Okay, well, let's get into the individuals first. The one, obviously, that everybody is worried about is Tom Holland, and whether or not he could pull off a Spider-Man movie. This was actually a lot more than people thought it might be, because, well, damn it, he had a lot to prove.
Yeah.
Tom Holland had to prove that he could do this role and that Marvel could take on Spider-Man after Sony has basically run it into the ground. Do we feel that he did that? I do, personally. Yep. And that, I hate saying that. I want to make sure that people understand this. I am so pissed at Sony, I don't want another Spider-Man movie for like another 10 years. Because they've made, they've made good decisions, but they made horrible decisions. And Amazing Spider-Man 2 and Spider-Man 3 are the perfect examples of those. So I was against Sony giving the rights to Spider-Man and letting Marvel do it. We've said this a couple of times now. I hate to say it. This kid made a good argument to do it. He was a good Peter Parker. His humor was there. His demeanor with Tony was there. It made sense for him to be in this movie. And not just as fight scene filler.
Yeah.
You know? I still think one of the better scenes in the entire movie was in the bedroom with Tony. Just because their ADD was awesome. It's like, so what do you actually do this? Because it's right. What's the tensile strength of that thing? What's the tensile strength of that webbing? So I'm going to let you kind of take this over because you were excited when Spider-Man got announced and when we got a new Spider-Man, a younger Spider-Man.
Yeah.
And then the costume comes out. You're not really all that thrilled.
Mm-hmm.
But how did the movie shape Peter Parker for you?
The movie, he's excellent. I'm excited to see Tom Holland take on Peter Parker here.
Yeah.
He did a great job. I can't say I had any... I don't want to say I had doubts. I don't know if I really did. Just Tom Holland. Yeah, don't really know him. Maybe he'll do okay.
But Tom Holland, I don't think, has a whole lot to his resume. He's a young British actor.
Yeah, fairly young actor. New
He's obviously younger than Andrew and Toby.
So, you know, I mean, if there's anything to slightly roll my eyes out at, it's just the fact that they've gone back to young Peter Parker again, because... I'm too accustomed to adult Peter Parker.
If it makes you feel any better, the comics have never let Peter grow up either.
Yeah, that's another issue, though. Just, you know, I want to see him work for the Daily Bugle and deal with J. Jonah Jameson. And,
fuck, I'm a picture of Spider-Man!
Or just
be his own guy.
Yeah.
You know
and, try and marry Mary Jane, because that's the thing, right? I get it. Spider-Man comics, long history... Many women.
And then he has to sell it to the devil.
He's got to sell his soul to the devil.
No, he's got to sell his marriage to the devil.
Yeah,
because marriage apparently kills all storytelling with characters. Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Okay, we got to get into this gripe really quick since we're talking about young, hot Aunt May. What the hell, Marvel?
We should have seen this coming when Marissa Tomei was announced.
I actually forgot completely walking into this. I forgot Marissa Tomei was cast as Aunt was cast in the movie, and then I'm like literally sitting there going, "Oh, is that supposed to be Mary Jane? Well, she's still a little older. Oh my gosh, is that supposed to be Aunt May?"
Yeah, it's Aunt May.
Are we actually doing this? Where we have hot Aunt May?
I think of Aunt May. I think of, you know, sweet, kindly old lady. I don't think of MILF material.
I really wish you hadn't used that word.
That's just the only way I can describe it. That's
I know, I know.
It's the way I was thinking about it in the theater. I'm like, this is not Aunt May. Aunt May is sweet little old lady.
Yes!
MILF material.
And I've read the comics, man. I've seen her go through shit. Where you feel bad for this sweet little old lady. You know, like, the perfect example is Spider-Man 2, where she goes to the bank, and she's, like, trying to get that account or whatever, and gets failed. But she at least gets the toaster, right? Nope. And it's like, oh, you feel bad for Aunt May. Oh, dude, she's really... Ah, damn it, no! Can't do that, no! Yeah, you can't do that. And by the way, so ADD moment, but I'm going to bring this up, because we had another kind of squicky moment in the movie. Where the grandniece of Peggy Carter and Cap kiss. And yes, this is a romance that they've kind of been building since Winter Soldier, when she was a S.H.I.E.L.D. agent watching Cap's back. Was I the only one that felt a little creeped out by that concept? It's like, oh, well, you were kind of hooking up with her grandmother. But at the same time, you know, he's the man outside of time. I mean, what are you going to do? He needs to have a relationship. But, the granddaughter.
That is a little weird. Yeah.
There's an age gap there, and it's like 50 plus years. It was so bad. And what made it worse for me was that we had the look back in the car, and both Sam and Bucky are like, yeah. No! No!
Oh, God.
So bad. But yeah, I was there for both of those moments. Sorry, we had to have the sidetrack, but I was there both moments. It was so hard to watch. But the bedroom scene was awesome.
Yeah.
Especially when... The only thing that I don't like that they've done is they made Peter kind of a scavenger.
Yeah, he's a dumpster diver.
He's a dumpster diver. He's looking for tech. And I get that that's part of the character, you know, where he's a smart science kid and he's always looking to improve the Spider-Man tech and all that. But I just didn't like the whole concept that we had to paint him as dumpster diver, scavenger kind of thing. Because Peter's always had, you know... I know that the Sam Raimi movies have not shown it, but he's always had, like, a modest living from the Daily Bugle and from being a student in college. He's always had kind of that modest living where he could afford the tech himself kind of thing. It was just the fact that he had the knowledge to be able to do it. That was the cool part. And so I don't like that concept, but it fits here. It makes sense for this Peter.
Yeah, I feel like that they're going to try and set up that Peter and Tony are going to become pretty close, like mentor-student-esque kind of.
I don't even know if they're setting that up, honestly.
Well, not then they should, because I think that's the good way to go. I mean, if you're gonna have Peter as a, you know, having.
I kind of hope they don't, and it's not because, like, I don't want to see an ego-driven Peter. Like, if anything, if you're gonna do that, then have Peter realize the mistakes that Tony's made in his life.
I don't think Peter's gonna become Tony 2.0. I just think that.
Tony's no, but come... but. Today, or the movie here was like, I'm trying to impress Tony Stark. I'm trying to impress Tony Stark.
Yeah.
And I want him to get past that.
You know, he's still a young kid and who's starry-eyed because...
Tony freaking Stark looked him up.
Tony Stark, yeah. I mean, obviously he must know who Tony Stark is. He's a science kid.
And figured out who he was.
Yeah. It's like going back to the Sam Raimi Spider-Man films with, you know, he knows who... Norman Osborn is, and he admires Norman Osborn's work, or Dr. Connors in the Amazing Spider-Man series, and here I feel like you could do the same thing with Iron Man, and just Tony kind of become almost a little protege of Tony.
I would just say, let's
have a lot of access to Stark Industry tech.
I would actually say don't give him access. Like, if you're going to let him be the scavenger, let him be the scavenger. You know, let him figure this out for himself. Just because I think that does a lot more towards Peter's character.
Yeah, but we've already
I'm really worried that if you go that route, though, go the Iron Spider. And I don't want to go that route. I actually don't like the Iron Spider.
I don't know that much about that. But I'm just saying, you know, we've already had the two origin stories of Peter struggling to figure out how to build web cartridges or use his powers.
Then let this be the origin.
This can't really be the origin because he's already clearly in tune with his powers and with his tech, right? Which is so,
what I'm saying is that we don't need the origin,
though. Yeah, that's the point. Yeah. And that's what I'm saying. This is a good way to.
We don't need hot Uncle Ben, okay? We don't need that.
Yeah, we don't need hot Uncle Ben.
We don't need that. We know enough. Like, I like the fact that we're at least kind of trusting that the viewer knows Peter's backstory and why it's important and all that stuff. If they want to do that with Stark Industries, then fine. But I'm saying I want Peter to figure out that Tony's a bit of a dick. Because then at that point, like, let's have Peter be on his own. I really don't want to be like, I only work for the beck and call of Tony Stark. No, that's not why Peter is a good character. Peter can figure these things out on his own. And this impressionable Peter Parker, I hope, is just a face from this movie. And that's it. Like, we get a Peter Parker that everybody's going to love and endear themselves to in Spider-Man Homecoming. Which I think is actually appropriate, because I wonder if the story in Homecoming is going to be right after this. And so this is going to be the backstory that we get for it.
When is Homecoming coming out? I don't remember.
I don't think we have a date yet.
Okay.
We know it's a Phase 3 movie, but that's it.
Do we know if it's this or next year?
Probably not even next year, I don't think.
Okay.
We'll check the line and we'll clarify this. So we talked a lot about Tom Holland and the fact that we do think that he's delivered a good Peter Parker, one that's believable, one that's relatable. one that we can all kind of get behind. Let's get into the other two characters, that one of which had existing development, but we've now since heard that we're going to get a sequel movie for him, and that is Ant-Man. So Paul Rudd comes back in this movie. We don't get a whole lot of backstory as to what he's been doing, aside from he's been working in a lab to modify the Ant-Man technology. And we know that from the Easter egg of Ant-Man that Hank Pym is working on the Wasp suit. So we know that much.
Yeah.
And so we have that set up for Ant-Man and the Wasp, which is the sequel movie we're going to get. With his development, first of all, I love the fact that we still kind of kept in that comedic character sense. Because, you know, one of the things we actually said when we watched Ant-Man was we loved the humor of it. And one of the reasons we loved the humor was because of who Scott Lang is. Mm-hmm. I especially love the, he meets with Cap, he's so excited, he's like, I'm continuing to shake your hand far longer than I should. I can't stop, I don't know what to tell you, man. And Cap's just like, it's okay. It's alright, I'm going with it. So I like that whole concept. I love the fact that we still had the Ant-Man shots of, and not just going into Tony's armor. We had the shrinking of the fuel truck and then throwing it, and he goes, oh crap, I thought that was a water truck. I thought that was awesome. I'm not demeaning Paul Rudd. I like the fact that they kept with the humor, but they also kept with the themes of Ant-Man for him, the shrinking, the, and in this case, expanding, where we get an experimental giant man.
Yeah.
And the fact that he does, like, where he moves super quick in the, he moves super quick according to his size, but then they'll zoom out and show how slow he's actually moving, and then you have the big lumbering giant man. I guess, first of all, what did you think of Giant Man? Because I told you that he was also known as that.
Right.
But I didn't know if we were going to see that anytime soon.
That's pretty cool. I like that.
I love the fact that he still used the little ninja star things.
Yeah.
From Hank Pym. I also kind of, the only thing that I was kind of worried about is they kind of hint that he's doing this against Hank Pym's wishes. But they don't really elaborate on that. Like, does Hank know where he is right now? Why he's not testing out the Ant-Man suit? I don't know if they actually answered that.
I didn't even catch
it. If anything, they reaffirmed the relationship between Hank Pym and Tony Stark.
Yeah.
But that's about it.
Yeah, that was the only thing I caught was, Mr. Pym said, never trust a Stark.
Yeah, and then we had him in the prison. I actually like that prison scene. I thought that was a really good moment where Tony had to come to face his own sins. And so he faced that in Hawkeye. He faced that in Falcon and in Ant-Man. But I thought Ant-Man was well used here. I thought they used his shots really, really well. I thought it was really awesome for him to go into Iron Man's suit and start taking it apart. And he starts talking in there. He's like, who's talking to me? Your conscience? We haven't talked in a while. Liquid coolant system Friday, go. You know? I thought that was a really cool moment. But does this get you amped up and excited for Ant-Man and the Wasp?
I've been excited since the first Ant-Man movie, so.
Yeah. So, I think this did a good job of it, and Paul Rudd obviously still can pull off the humor. It's awesome.
Yeah.
And then the other one that people want to know our opinions on, which is setting up for another new Wave 3 movie, and that is Chadwick Boseman as Prince T'Challa and the Black Panther. Now, this is a character that you don't know a whole lot of history with.
Yeah, I don't know anything about Black Panther, really.
Really, your knowledge here is what Age of Ultron and this movie have taught you, mm-hmm. which is Wakanda exists, Wakanda is where Vibranium is from, which is what makes up Cap's shield. It also makes up the suit that Black Panther wears. the only thing that they didn't really go into was the backstory, and I'm kind of disappointed by that because Black Panther, did you ever see the old Billy Zane movie, The Phantom?
No.
Did you see the series that Fox did, Phantom 2040?
No.
Okay. So the premise of The Phantom is like a father and son, or like the father is the Phantom, and then when the father dies, it passes on to the son, and he becomes the next Phantom. That's the same concept for Black Panther, where the king of the nation of Wakanda is the Black Panther. And then when the king passes away, it is inherited by the son. So that's how it goes in the original comic, where T'Chaka passes away, and T'Challa then becomes the Black Panther. And Black Panther is... I'm trying to think of a good comparison as far as super... Like, he's not superhuman by any stretch. He is homegrown and trained. He is a warrior. But he's also kind of like a... He's super smart. He's kind of like a Batman, where he knows a lot about the world, even though Wakanda's not part of it. I believe in the comics, they actually have him go out to learn amongst the world. He's learned at all the major prestigious universities and is a known diplomat, and he can do all of that stuff. But then he goes back to Wakanda and he applies that to their nation. And also you can kind of tell that the nation of Wakanda is fairly more advanced than the rest of the Marvel Universe, based off of what we actually saw of Wakanda. Mm-hmm. But it's also very spiritual. It's very elemental. In fact, one of the things that the comics do occasionally is, like, the Black Panther is seen as a ghost. It's seen as a myth. It doesn't exist because, well, the Black Panther is not needed as often as people might think. So this was another movie that had to be sold to you as kind of a new viewer. And whether, because this is going to be a Wave 3 movie. So you got a little bit of access with Chadwick outside of the costume as well as in the costume. You got to see the costume and what he could do in it. What were your thoughts on the Black Panther? Does it get you excited to go see his movie?
Yeah, I'm interested. Because Black Panther seems like an interesting character that I want to see more of.
And in that concept, like, how do you find that interesting? Just because he's more of a peaceful character, or
I think that's it. It's the whole kind of concept of the character itself is it's different from what I've seen before out of Marvel heroes. Mm-hmm. And just I want to learn more about this character. I want to see what the abilities of this character is. Mm-hmm. I guess you could say it'd be like, well, it's like Scarlet Witch now. Even when I saw Age of Ultron, well, I became interested by what Scarlet Witch and
yep.
Quicksilver are like. So, and now I'm interested in, well, what's Black Panther like?
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's like that with any kind of new hero that you've seen for the first time, but you've never seen him before otherwise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like what they did with, I think Chadwick did a good job playing T'Challa.
Mm-hmm.
So don't take that out of context. Like, I'm not criticizing that concept. I don't think he got a whole lot of spotlight that he should have from the movie, but that's just because I really do think that the whole Black Panther storyline was shoehorned in because they shoehorned in Wakanda in Age of Ultron.
Mm-hmm.
And so at that point they had to go, oh, well, Wakanda is now a thing. We're having their king come out and want these Sokovian Accords. And then he dies, and now we have a revenge story. That I actually liked that he was the guy that kind of puts the stop to it. You know, he's the brother, my brother, and he had to be the one to say, no, I'm not going to kill you. I will serve justice, not vengeance. So I think we have a good pick in Chadwick Boseman as T'Challa, and I'm looking forward to the Black Panther movie to see what they do with it. Because now that we have the Avengers out in Wakanda, I'm interested to see what they'll actually do with him. Like, will this be a prequel in T'Chaka's hands? And actually, no, because Chadwick was the first one to get cast. So this will be like, you know, is he defending Wakanda from the Avengers trying to get Cap? Or how is that going to go? Or is this just going to be an internal Black Panther problem? So yeah, I think all the new heroes were properly displayed the way that they needed to be. But let's get into the dislikes of the film. You have a few dislikes. I'm interested to see what you have to say.
Oh, I think it's more like one giant gripe with the film.
Mm-hmm.
And most of the action scenes are really good. I think the action scenes are staged well and they're fought well. But my problem, and this is a problem not just in the action scenes, it's in a lot of the movie, it's a problem we've brought up many times, and that is shaky cam to hell.
Yeah, that did happen a couple of times.
This, The photography is so, it's again very, and it's not just shaky cam.
Funniest thing, I don't know if you noticed, like a lot of the shaky cam actually happened with Spider-Man to some extent, like with his swinging around.
Even before Spider-Man. I mean, yeah. From the very first action scene of this to Captain versus the Iron Man. God, I don't know.
Cap and Iron Man. Not only that, but like having the shaky cam happen with Crossbones in that fight. Because it blurs the focus on it. It doesn't allow us to see, you know, the towering threat that Crossbones is to Cap. It's like we can't tell.
Yeah, everything was quick, and the scenes were also edited a little too rapidly that it was really hard to just focus. Right before actually coming to watch the movie with you, I watched honest trailers of the 1990 Captain America, and they actually run a counter up of how many cuts there are in one action scene, how many edits there are, and that's what I was thinking of. Like, okay, stop cutting for 3 seconds so I can watch it, you know?
Yeah,
and it's sort of weird because I know this is sort of a trait Michael Bay does a lot, but again, I feel Bay cuts with the action rather than cuts around the action. I feel most editors cut around. It's hard to explain. I just feel like so many editors don't know how to cut a lot of these action scenes, and that they think, oh, if we just cut, it's going to make it look fast.
And also the growing concept of whenever we have an explosion, we have to have the shaky cam. Yeah. Almost as if the explosion is affecting the cam. And here's the thing, it actually hurts it, as far as I'm concerned, because you don't see the devastation that this explosion is about to create from that.
We want to see the impact of everything. Shaky cam has a place, steady cam has a place, but don't abuse it. I know sometimes they have to work around stunt actors and that.
Here was actually a good example in this movie of appropriate shaky cam use, where they did the whole New York, Sokovia, and all of that looked like found footage.
Yeah,
that makes sense because there would be bystanders that would be recording this because of how outlandish it is.
Yeah.
That makes sense for shaky cam because that's a YouTube account.
Mm-hmm.
Or the YouTube accounts of Spider-Man. That makes sense if it's that. But when you have explosions being the shaky cam,
when we have the final fight between Captain America and Iron Man duking it out, about ready to kill each other,
You want is a headache while Cap is literally jamming his shield into the chest plate. That takes away from it. It takes you out of it. It takes the passion out of that moment.
Yeah. So that would be my biggest gripe with the movie here is it's the editing's a little too choppy for its own good, and there's way too much shaky cam in the action scenes that it was a little hard to watch and get a full feel of these action scenes.
I would tend to agree with that. I think there was a lot of shaky cam moments that hurt the film and took you out of it. I will also say another problem with it was we've talked a lot about the characters, but then now I get to get into these underutilized characters. Martin Freeman shows up in this movie, and I thought he was wasted because he doesn't feel necessary. He's random agent number 37. That you could have had anybody play, but you had Martin Freeman play it.
Oh, it's Martin Freeman.
I don't care. Utilize him properly. You know, like, put him in a prominent role. Like, have him be the Secretary of State, for crying out loud.
That's what I was asking. I was like, that's Martin Freeman, really?
Yeah, Martin Freeman, Bilbo.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, the guy who later is interrogating Zemo.
Right.
That's Martin Freeman.
Oh.
Mr., I'm going to flip the camera off every time it's improperly on me.
Yeah, you kind of confused me that, because you said Bilbo went from Hobbit to Douche. I'm like, that's not Ian Holm. What the heck are you talking about?
He went for Ian Holm. And it was Martin Freeman. No, it's one of the jokes that's being made right now. It's like Benedict Cumberbatch is... since Benedict and Martin are part of Sherlock, and then, you know, Benedict got the role as Smaug. Martin Freeman got the role of Bilbo, and then eventually Benedict got the role of Smaug. So it's just like, Benedict has to follow Martin, and Martin has to follow Benedict.
Yeah.
And so the joke right now that's being made is since Benedict got the Doctor Strange role, Martin Freeman had to find his way into the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And here you go, Agent 37!
Oh, that's pretty funny.
So I felt like Martin was improperly used. I also felt William Hurt was improperly used. Because he didn't get a whole lot of screen time. Like, it, and the thing I'm comparing it to is, like, compare it to, John Redford? No, is that the right name?
Oh, no, who are you thinking?
Robert Redford. Where he was the Secretary of S.H.I.E.L.D. in Winter Soldier,
mm-hmm.
but he was Hydra.
Mm-hmm.
That was a great build-up, and that was a great character. And William Hurt, I felt, was overshadowed by everything else. And I like that actor and some of the things that he's done. And I felt like, yeah, I get why you're doing this role. You're a typical Secretary of State, your old guy that we're bringing in that's a politician. But I felt like you could have put him in as anybody, and it would have worked. You could have put him in as a random ambassador that T'Chaka meets, and it would have worked. And so at that point, if you're going to bring in these big name actors, when you're already paying Robert Downey Jr., you're already paying Chris Evans, you're already paying Paul Bettany to come in and do these roles, let's not waste the budget by bringing these actors in and then not utilizing them.
Mm-hmm.
Or putting them in C-based roles in these movies just because we want to have a cameo. Look, Stan Lee can get away with that because Stan Lee's like 95. And it's funny to see him play the FedEx guy. But I'm pretty sure that he's not doing that necessarily for the money as much the cameo. Because at that point, that's Stanley's shtick. He's the cameo in his own films. Or in his own universe. So, that and the other thing was Paul Bettany. I thought was a little underutilized. And I thought it was a little silly for him to be walking around in the red and green makeup. And then wearing a formal attire.
Yeah, that was a little weird. He's like wearing a sweater.
And before people bring this up, I'm pretty sure in the comics he did the exact same thing at some points, like when they had to go meet the public or whatever. But it felt so weird, especially since, like, you know the lengths that they have to go through to put his face in that. It's like, don't cut corners here, people! Just let him be Vision! And I'm pretty sure Paul probably said that. He's like, I don't want to have, like, this full four-hour day where you make me red and green.
Well, I doubt it's even 4 hours, man.
No, it's at least 4 hours. It's more than that.
It's probably like 12 hours.
Yeah, so at that point, it was basically cutting budget corners. But it felt so silly to have him talking to the Secretary of State in this shirt and sweater vest.
Yeah.
And it's like, dude, you're a guy who's got a red face.
Yeah, that's so weird. You just expect him to be in costume all the time, because he's not like the others who are all essentially human. He's artificial. So, yeah, I would have definitely said, nix the sweater.
I almost wanted a little bit more like a Data reaction with him, where he's curious.
Mm-hmm.
And he isn't. He's figured things out to an extent.
Well, we get that with the cooking scene when he's trying to...
Yeah, he gets a little frustrated there, but, like, when it comes to relationships, he doesn't know anything, and you get the curiosity.
Mm-hmm.
But when he's talking to the Secretary of State, it's like he's talking to frickin' Thor again. And it's like, no! You should be wondering who the heck this guy is and why he matters! And I felt that was a little weird, but I'm not gonna fault Paul Bettany. He did great! This is Paul Bettany we're talking about. The guy who's been playing Jarvis for so long. It was only appropriate that he did as well as he did. I especially love the hospital moment where, you know, he's at fault for Rhodey. And he feels bad for it. I also especially felt bad for him when we had that moment of Scarlet Witch kind of betraying him and throwing him into the basement. You know, that was a hard scene to watch because you'd seen all the buildup that they had done. Like, he was a reluctant person, or he was reluctant to keep her prisoner within the Avengers mansion.
Mm-hmm.
Those were all really heartfelt moments, and I felt they were really well done, and then we'd have this moment where he's in the freaking sweater vest. And it's just like, hi, Vision! Hi! Why are you in that outfit?
Why are you dressed like Mr. Rogers?
Yeah, exactly. Would you be mine? Would you be my neighbor? Well, he brings out Thor's hammer. So, yeah, I would say that those are kind of my gripes with it. A lot of the other design was well done. I especially love the fact that they kept common sense here and kept their fight scene to an airport. Because I'm like, yeah, that's for better feeling, people. Because then you don't have to worry about collateral damage and having to CG that. No, all you have to do is say, okay, that there, we're going to show it getting smashed, and we're fine.
Yes, an airport as opposed to a rock quarry.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I mean, that's Rock Warrior would be super easy.
Yeah, I mean, that's a little Power Rangers joke, but
I'm more comparing it with, like, Avengers 1, where it's in a city, you know? And you have to show all this collateral damage. The Russo brothers did a good job of keeping it into, an open airport where they could get a lot of really great shots of Cap's team and Iron Man's team running at each other. So we've talked a lot in this video. I'm pretty sure it's going to be like over an hour long. I feel bad for you. So let's kind of wrap things up. So final score on Captain America Civil War, Alex, how did this film do for you?
I guess all things considered, little bit of flaws aside, I'm going to give this movie a 9.
Okay. I'm going to give it a 9 as well, and I'm going to stick with what I've said about Winter Soldier. I really honestly believe that Captain America movies have done what Man of Steel and Batman v Superman could not.
Yeah.
Where they showed kind, benevolent superheroes, and even when they're fighting, they can come together for the common good. Especially in the concept of collateral damage, because there's no room for doubt that after that building exploded, that Cap calls in the rescue team and he doesn't go in there himself to start rescuing people. Mm-hmm. There's no doubt in my mind that he did that. Whereas the Henry Cavill Superman, I have doubts that he would. I have doubts that Ben Affleck went in there to go save people as Batman. And I shouldn't feel like that. Not with the embodiments of hope and justice. And so, again, I'm going to say the Russo brothers have done what Zack Snyder could not. They showed kind, benevolent superheroes that could still kick ass and chew bubble gum at the same time.
And have a lot more levity in between the seriousness of this movie compared to just long 3 hours of dreariness with Batman v Superman.
Yeah, this is going to be a really bad story to tell, but I'm just going to tell it. In this movie, there was so much going on and so much that I didn't want to lose track of. I've got this drink right here, and I was already doing some editing work before I walked in there, where it was just like, I have to pee right now, but I don't want to miss a damn thing. I didn't have this problem in Batman v Superman, but now I kind of wished I had, because then I would have gotten at least a 3-minute break from all the dark and dreary. Whereas this one actually, it had dark and dreary moments, but it at least left me hopeful. It at least left me feeling like there was a light at the end of the tunnel for this confrontation. The other thing I guess we need to bring up a little bit is the Star Wars comparisons that are being made to Civil War right
Come on,
now.
There's only two.
Well, the ones that people want to bring up are the chopping off of arms. The ending Easter egg where they're looking out on a window. There's actually a lot of Star Wars comparisons being made now, and I love the people that are making the joke that's like, this is the reason Disney bought Star Wars, is so they can make these jokes. And, well, yeah, it works.
And Peter referencing Empire Strikes Back.
Yes.
That's such a great movie. It's like, how old is this kid? I don't know, I didn't carbon date him.
I forgot about the carbon dating, yeah. You remember that one scene where with the big walkers? Hang on, I think I get where he's going here. I think that was more along the lines of not just doing a Star Wars joke, but also just dating Tony compared to Peter, where Peter's a high school kid. And so therefore he shouldn't know what Empire Strikes Back is.
Yeah.
Although, guys, typical high school geek, he would know what Empire Strikes Back is. So you had that moment. What was the other one that gets brought up? Obviously the chopping off of Bucky's arm being a big deal. The fact of Iron Man's one of his cutting lasers being kind of used as a lightsaber to deflect or to keep Cap out of the action. I just think it was them saying, well, now that we have the Star Wars license, let's have a little fun, you know?
They already did that with Tomorrowland.
They did it with, well, they're doing it with Tomorrowland, and they're also doing it with the Marvel Universe.
I don't mean the theme park Tomorrowland, I meant the movie.
When they had all the
Star Wars stuff.
I get what you mean.
Yeah, sure.
But I thought it was still fun. I thought the jokes were still in good taste, so I didn't have a major problem with it.
Yeah.
Although it would have been funny if you had a Stan Lee cameo, you had a John Boyega cameo where he's Prince T'Challa's aide. It's like, ah, Finn! The other thing that the people I know are going to ask, at least me, on this regard is, like, how do we feel that the Russo brothers have done, since they are now the directors for Infinity War? So, Joss is not coming back for Avengers 3, mm-hmm. and they have just barely appointed the Russo brothers, who have been doing, I want to say Cap 1, but I don't think they were involved. They were involved in Cap 2, and now they're involved in this one, and whether or not these guys have the right to take up that mantle. I think, in all honesty, since this is technically a mini Avengers movie, you have your answer.
Yeah.
I think that they will do well, because, I mean, really the only difference here is that you don't have the Hulk involved, you don't have Thor involved, and given that everybody got a spotlight, everybody got a cool fight scene moment, I have no problem letting them take the reins for Infinity War. Especially with this one. And since we're both giving it a solid 9, I don't think that's going to be the case. As far as paying for this movie, we didn't see it in 3D.
No.
It probably would be pretty good in 3D. There was a lot of CG usage, especially in the fight scenes. I think that would just be like, it would be adding a roller coaster to them, essentially.
I'd say I wouldn't advise 3D, because again, the shaky cam with this, you're going to get dizzy.
Tend to not like the gimmick, period, but like, if you want to do that, this would be one of those movies where I would say, yeah, go ahead, because there's enough CG to justify it. You know, and people actually ask me that comparison, like, how do you justify it? The first Iron Man movie, I wouldn't justify in 3D. There's not enough of the suit to justify that. I'm talking when the movie is at least 60% in these kinds of shots where you're seeing the Iron Man suit, and when you're seeing all these elements, then it's worth it. But when it's like Iron Man, where it's 80% Tony Stark and 20% Iron Man, no, it's not worth it. I would recommend prime time. Take your friends, get some popcorn, have some fun, because yeah, you're going to have plenty of it here. So that's like, you know, $10-$12 per ticket right there, because you're going to like 7 o'clock at night on Friday. I actually think I'd see this again, in all honesty. Mm-hmm. I'm taking my wife to this, because she didn't go with us. So is that kind of your verdict too, or?
Minus 3D, but I'd say it's worth any time, any price that you want to see it for.
And if you're a big enough fan, go do 3D, just for the heck of it. Do a gimmick and see if you enjoy it even more. In fact, write a comment on whether or not you think it was a good idea. We'd love to hear.
D-Box 3D, let us know.
Exactly. Or go to, like, we have an Atmos theater near us. We didn't see it in Atmos, but I would love to hear this in Atmos. I think it would be awesome. So I think that's going to go ahead and wrap up this very long review of Captain America Civil War. And I feel kind of bad, because the next time that you guys will be seeing us will be for the Marvel Universe falling apart again.
Oh, jeez.
When we go take on X-Men Apocalypse. So that will be in later May, and then we get to see supposedly the final X-Men movie, and the final appearance of Hugh Jackman as Wolverine. Yeah, right, I'll believe that when I see it. But yeah, so we'll be back next time for X-Men Apocalypse.
Or hopefully we don't have to welcome to die.
But I am Magneto, Master of Magnet. Go, X-Men!